I do have skills that make me a nightmare for people like you.
Hello, darkness, my old friend. I've come to talk with you again.
G'day, everybody. It is 10 past 8 and on the 9th of February we're on our way into court to go and have some fun, you know. And I was figuring while I was at court, it's probably a good idea when you're on a court to have some exercise, so I'm going to be exercising some rights while I'm there. So long awaited hearing. Remember, I haven't even entered a plea. Judge Black entered a plea in July. I entered a motion after that to have that plea struck, as the judge did that against my wishes, intent and direction. The judge can order that under the Criminal Procedure Act 2011, I think it is, section 39 and 49, the judge can deem a not guilty plea if the defendant is not willing or reluctant to enter a plea. The fact that I was standing there holding one up in my hand.
Am I entitled to make a full and complete plea?
I deem not guilty plea.
Are you entering so my intention today is to enter a fully signed plea of guilty. I have one right here in my hand.
All right, well,
I'll interrupt you. I have some questions to ask before I can do that.
The fact that I was standing there holding one up in my hand got rid of any reluctance whatsoever. That my intent was clear, but they couldn't give me the answers I required, so that's how they got around that one. So yeah, that got removed, and we're still, as Judge put it, in a preliminary stage, waiting for these stuff-ups of the New Zealand police to get ironed out. But it's not going to happen because, well, there's just too many. There's too many fuck-ups. I did hear back from my mate Mike McMurtry from the police. You might notice on page 35 of the transcript, Mike refers to a report compiled by Kelly Ryan of the Infringement Bureau. That report I've never seen and never been entered into evidence, and he certainly didn't supply it after the order to produce disclosure from the judge. And it was only a couple of weeks ago, after asking him about it, that he actually supplied it. Now, this report shows what Kelly Ryan created, you know, 3 copies of the photo, 2 copies of the summary of facts, witness list, all the shit. Well, it doesn't say 3 copies of everything. 3 copies, I would expect, one for the court, one for the prosecutor, one for me. It's only 3 copies of the photo, which stands more to reason that it only backs up that I didn't get anything else. Otherwise, she should have compiled 3 copies of everything. Now, Mike has said that this doesn't actually prove that I was sent them in, and it's true. The presumption in law is that I have been sent the documents, unless I object to it otherwise. And because I objected and had evidence in the way of those letters asking for the same stuff time and time again, proof's there. So this is where we stand. We are waiting to see what the judge wants to rule on it. I've got the automatic acknowledgement emails from the police prosecutions every time I sent a letter, which proves that I sent them on the days that I sent them. I've sent that 20-page motion for dismissal. I've sent a 3-page motion for costs. I had an interesting email from the amicus curiae in this matter, and all he seems to want to do is to get me to confess that I was there that day and that I was driving. He's even stated That's the sole purpose for me being at court, is for them to decide whether or not I was there driving. I would have thought the sole purpose of being at court is to have justice and due process of law followed. But apparently, that's none, no, the never mind, you know. It's just not what a lawyer of 50 years' experience seems to think. He seems to think I have to answer the police's questions. He seems to think that there is no such thing as the onus probandi, or the burden of proof lays at the feet of the prosecutor or he who makes the claim. But all this will come out in court. Now, I've also filed a notice or application that I will be wanting to record or wish to exercise my pre-existing rights to receive, gather and impart information in regards, and I specified in the form of a video recorder, and that's that. So I have got no response back from the registry. The registry asked me to clarify exactly what I wanted. I clarified exactly what I wanted and they didn't give me any answers. And to be quite honest, all I really care about getting from the registry is proof one way or the other, evidence that shows whether or not the police did file what they say they produced or gave me back in May. Or if they gave it to me, they should have also filed it at the registry at that time. And the registry, if they're doing their fucking job properly, which they aren't, should be able to stamp it and show me a copy of a stamped filed document of what they say I was given. It's that simple. And it hasn't been. There's no disclosure index, which is something I expect to get, because I got one last time I questioned all of this shit. So, yeah. You know, onward and upward. I'm probably an hour away from getting in there as it stands. We'll see how we go. Till then, catch up with you. I'm sure I'll fill you in afterwards and let you know how it all went on. See ya.
Six and a half hours later.
Hey guys, it is 20 to 6. We were in court for a good 4 hours today, off and on. We didn't leave until about 5 o'clock tonight. Heard our case for at least 2.5-3 hours this afternoon before we couldn't come to any summary or conclusion. All we got to hear was the evidence, back to some courts. I've been asking where the obligation for myself to make a statutory declaration is. If I was not the driver, where's that obligation? Because as far as I know, it's not my obligation to say anything that may help the police in the prosecution of somebody. Unfortunately, it has now been adjourned. I will be going back for now my fourth appearance in regards to an $80 speeding ticket. It's costing probably $24 in parking each time I've gone there. So I've spent $100 in parking just to deal with this matter, as opposed to paying the $80 ticket. So if someone wants to say I'm just trying to get out of paying the ticket, think again. I'm paying more challenging the ticket than I am than just paying it. Most people who would be working all day would lose hundreds of dollars in lost earnings that day too. Luckily for everyone out there, I don't have lost earnings, I just have lost time. And time is irreplaceable. So, the DUT 244 manual, dated from 2001, is now obsolete. According to him, it's because there's new cameras and new detections, and back in those days it was all film. None of which has any relevance to the use of a laser or radar detection device, because that's got nothing to do with the camera. So I'm going to be asking the New Zealand Police to supply me this new operator's manual 2009, where I'm going to be asking the prosecutor to supply the manual that he was referring to in the transcript, and expect them to supply it, because if he's going to say that what I was referring to is obsolete and it's now due to a new thing, how about you cough up the new thing for me to look at? I got a response back in regards to chasing the phone call.
As far as tracking a phone call from an officer to the infringement bureau is concerned, the infringement bureau keep track of internal extension to internal extension and from external to internal extension. What they don't keep track of or logs of are the mobile device calls. You have to get a production order from a judge to allow Vodafone to release the phone records of that operator or of that police officer's particular phone number so I can track the calls. They can't do it. So if you know an officer's made a phone call from a cell phone, there's no point asking them, because unless you've got a production order to Vodafone or to whoever their service provider is, you won't get that information. So I found out. Isn't learning a wonderful thing? So I'm not going to be able to publish or release any of the stuff, and I've got quite stuck up. I think I'm up to part 17 now of this saga that I've got all set ready to release, but it looks like there's going to be some new parts to be added because this shane ain't over. The same judge in the same courtroom, so it was courtroom 11 again. The judge stated that there is no video or audio recording of the proceedings, and yet in the second breath stated that the transcript offer takes the audio recording from the court and produces the transcript from it. So either they audio record the pling or not. I would have thought, given the electronic mics all over the counters, that they are doing some sort of audio recording, just not video. I did confirm that there is not a camera in the top corner of that courtroom. The judge has put a speedy request on the transcript from today, because it seems to be, no matter what happens on the day, it's when I ask for the transcript and when I actually get the transcript and I get to read the transcript, and that's where I detect the problems. Okay? Because you can only go by what's already entered into evidence. So if you don't have the transcripts, you can't keep going in for round 2, 3, 4 and so on. My motion for costs is going to be different, obviously, because now I'm going to be doing a fourth appearance, which is another $226. So I'm all good with that. To judge, my hat goes off, dear. You really are acting as an impartial adjudicator. And I really got to take my hat off to you. You know, if I'd struck Tim Black again, I guarantee you I'd be saying the complete freaking opposite. Because Tim Black needs to have his fucking, he needs to be put in his place, quite frankly. And I'd add, I come out from court at lunchtime and there's people outside protesting with loudspeakers and posters all about SIFs and police corruption, court corruption, and how judges are all, you know, they get paid 5 years after they finish working. They still get paid at the judge's salary for another 5 years afterwards.
They just leave it for the judge to use their own discretion and abuse parents. This is what they do. They don't protect children. Move on. Okay, judge, why did I ask Ian Bakabi? Ian Bakabi, assistant.
Good job, guys.
Family judge. I asked him, why did you take the away from my son for 9 months? He said, oh.
Adjudicators cannot be held responsible. They can't be prosecuted. So they really are doing whatever they like without any care to the fact that they'll be held accountable for anything, because they know they won't be. That's why they get away with it. I am having an immense amount of fun, far more than I'd be spending the same amount of money at a pub through the night getting drunk and drowning my sorrows about life, or far more than I would from just paying the ticket, being a good obedient little servant. And the amount of information and knowledge that isn't written, that you pick up from doing this is astounding. If people or anyone wants to know, how do you start this process? How do you, where do you start? What should you look at first? The answer is very, very clear. If you go to Japan and you start talking English, do you think they're going to hear you? Do you think they're going to understand you? No, because you're not speaking Japanese. If you go to Taiwan, do you think they're going to understand you for speaking English there? No, they're going to speak Taiwanese. So when you're going into a legal setting where lawyers and barristers and attorneys all hang out, you best learn their language, legalese. So the first thing I did many years ago when I first wanted to start learning law and challenging it, is I invested, well I didn't actually invest, I got them given to me as Christmas presents. I got a Black's 6th edition law dictionary, and I got myself a New Zealand Butterworth's 5th edition law dictionary. They, and spend some time going through them. I know you must be thinking, how boring reading a dictionary. It's not. It's actually really entertaining. When you look up what you think a word is, in the Oxford dictionary or a normal English dictionary, and then you look up what that word means in a law dictionary, boring is hardly what I would define it as. Enlightening, shocking, disturbing, all of those other words come into play, but boring isn't one of them. Not if you have a thirst for a bit of knowledge. So if you guys want to learn how to stand up for yourself, you know, comprehend how the system works, how societal structures stuff, you need to learn how it's all in the language that it's all written in. So first things first, understand the meanings of words. Study a lot of Jordan Maxwell. He's really good at that sort of thing. You need to learn to articulate how to put things, because it will certainly give them pause. You know, Burles at speed, what the fuck are you on about? That won't work. You know, I accept your claim for value provided you can establish proof of jurisdiction, claim and authority. That does. So, yeah. All I can say is, learn the words. End of my little rant. I'm sorry I can't show you guys anything of what's been going on since the preliminary hearing in July, but like I say, nothing of any to do with what's going on with the case is going to be is going to cause prejudice, and I'm not going to release any information in regards to this matter until it finishes. I don't mind giving it a slight opinion as to what's going on, but I'm not going to go into facts and detail about it until afterwards, because that would be to my detriment. Roger didn't really seem like he was into talking to me much for the first half of the day. I guess got put in his place a few times. He still maintains that I'm only there in court to ascertain who the driver was. That's all they want to know. And I've stuck to my guns and says, mate, I'm in court to state that I'm innocent and to hear some allegation against me. And unless I can have the burden of proof satisfied beyond reasonable doubt, I ain't going to accept jack shit. And guess what? It's not up to me to confess. Witness testimony alone is not enough to convict. You can say, well, there was 80k signs and here's my photograph to prove it. Well, they can say, the signs were up and they were legal, because it's put in the Gazette, here's a copy of the Gazette to prove it. But saying, or just hide the spitball here, shall we? But saying, well, it was gazetted and I checked with my boss and he said it was, well, that's hearsay. You don't have first-hand knowledge. You didn't read the Gazette where it said that, so how do you know? The detection device was set to 91 in an 80k area, supposedly. 91 would mean that you don't get a chance to get a $30 ticket. It's instantly $80 or higher. So by setting the camera detection to not even give the people a chance to get a $30 ticket, well, again, it's all about the money. Enough of my rambling. See you later, guys. Have a good one. Whisper.
silent.